So a bunch more content came out about Persona 3 Reload, the remake of the original Persona 3 from Atlus, and I saw this gif on Twitter today and it occurred to me that it might be interesting to try to recreate the battle transition that the game uses. I know, my life truly must be so interesting that this is what I do with my time. If your life is more interesting than mine, then, I don't know, subscribe about it or something, that'll really show me. Anyway, when the protagonist attacks a shadow, you get this blue silhouette of the main character which gets diamond wiped into the arena and then the fight starts. How might one achieve this transition in Unreal Engine, hypothetically? Well, I already made something vaguely akin to it about my OC Red Cube, who is the protagonist of Persona 5 Dancing 2 Dancing in Swindon. In this tech demo looking thing, you have this static shot of Red Cube sort of hovering, then when you hit the spacebar you get the blue line come across, and then the camera pans away from it and you get diamond wiped from the silhouette space to the real world again. Nothing fancy, but gets the job done. To achieve the diamond effect, we use stencils and post-processing materials, both of which I had explained to me by better tutorializers than I, whose content I'll put all over the screen and in the description, but I'll go over the broad strokes of how it all works here. Unreal Engine's own tutorial on the subject goes into more detail about the stencil buffer, but for our purposes all we need to know is that stencils are a means of separating objects in the world into different, I suppose, layers that our post-processing material can render in different ways. To make sure the stencil system's enabled, go to your project settings, type in custom depth, and make sure that custom depth stencil pass is filled and is enabled with stencil. Next, we create a new Unreal material, which I called PPM Persona Fade In. PPM Persona Fade In contains this Byzantine material blueprint which we'll walk through bit by bit. I'm gonna save doing too many memes from this part of the video onward because I feel that would be distracting. Up here, we use two constant three-vector nodes. These three-vector nodes are really just a means by which we can plug solid colors into the material, you know, RGB, right? We don't even need to mess with those numbers directly, we can just pick the color that's already on the node and change it up using Unreal's color picker. Anyway, the two vector threes we have are blue and black, and we want the blue to be covering our little silhouette guy, and black to be covering everything else, so that we have the starting point of the transition effect. We need a way to tell Unreal what has to be covered in blue, and so that's where the stencils come in. Back in our Unreal scene, we can take our red cube, go to the details panel here, and give it a custom depth stencil value of 1. You can find this setting by just typing custom depth in the search bar. Doing this will mean it's picked up by our material later. To check that it'll get picked up, you can change the render view in the scene from lit to buffer visualization custom stencil, and then you'll hopefully see the cube now has these funny numbers on it. That means it's working. Back to PPM Persona Fade In again, and now all we have to do is get that stencil data. We can do this by creating a scene texture node, which basically just gives the, like, texture of the camera view. So like this. Anyway, we choose custom stencil, buried at the bottom of the list as our scene texture ID. We can plug that into a component mask node, which will mask out everything that's stenciled from everything that isn't, which we can in turn provide to a linear interpolation node to decide what parts should be blue and what parts should be black. To understand what's going on here, it's useful to think of the linear interpolation or LERP node simply as a means of alternating between two values, right? In this case, we want certain pixels on the screen to be blue and certain other pixels to be black. So the LERP node takes black as A and blue as B, so it knows which two colors to LERP between. But it still needs a way to determine what should be what, and that's what the mask does. It takes all the objects that we've stenciled out, which is Red Cube, and converts those pixels from the scene view into information that the alpha of the LERP node can interpret. This gives us this result. That's already pretty good, but obviously with no means of converting this to this, we can't really get the desired effect. To convert between one and the other in a clean way, we'll need to engage in an arcane practice known as coordinate geometry. I don't like it. Essentially, we need to do the LERP process against the whole screen again, but this time we need a way to mask the screens so that it's either rendering our black and blue combination or just rendering the usual color that we're getting through the camera, you know, normally, right? Fortunately, Unreal also comes with a node called Screen Position, which lets you do different things based on where a pixel is on the player's view. If you imagine the viewport is running 0 to 1 along the top and 0 to 1 top to bottom, then every point on the screen can be expressed as a coordinate. The middle would be 0.5, 0.5, this would be 0.2, 0.4, and so on. You hopefully get the idea. Anyway, we can use that information to do different things to different pixels based on where they are. Here's all of that coordinate geometry calculation in action. We start here at Scene Position. When you see this, imagine that we're actually just checking each of these pixels in turn to see if it matches our criteria for being changed from the black and blue to the in color. Next, we mask out the red and green channels using the same mask node as before. We take those channels because the red channel gives us the x coordinate of a pixel and the green channel gives us the y coordinate. I don't know, don't ask. If we combine those again in a make float 2, we now have a coordinate of a pixel on the screen that we can test. In order to know whether a given coordinate is inside of a diamond shape, we have to use this equation I found on Stack Overflow. I don't know the theory or understand why it works, I just know that it does and that smarter mathematicians than I came up with it. Fortunately, I do know how to turn this notation into blueprint terminology, and so will you. First, we need a reference to the center point of the diamond. We can put this anywhere on the screen, really, but to get it to line up with where it is in the GIF, I think 0.7.5 is probably fine. We take that central coordinate and we use a subtract node to take it away from the given pixel coordinate to satisfy this first bit. That's all we needed the float 2 for, and so now we can use a breakout node to break it into its individual x and y again so we can run all this logic on it. We then need to multiply the absolute version of the x coordinate, that is, if it's negative, it becomes positive, which, Actually, it probably won't ever be negative, so we don't need that, but I don't know, better to be safe than sorry, probably. It still works. We need to multiply x by the radius of the diamond on the x, which is the length of this line, and y by the radius on the y, and then add them both up and check whether the resulting value is less than or equal to the value of the x radius and y radius of the diamond multiplied. Again, I don't know why this is correct, I just know that it is. I'm not a mathematician, please don't hurt me. At this point, it'd be useful if we had a means of actually controlling what the radius is. If we can adjust the radius at runtime, we can change the size of the diamond, and that would let us get this effect where the diamond appears to be growing and swapping the colors around as it expands. To do this, we need to create a material parameter collection. Material parameters are useful for exactly this sort of use case where properties of a material might need to be set by a designer, or even where you might want parts of a material to change. To make one, right-click in the content browser and go Material Parameter Collection. This gives you a list that looks like this. We need two scalar parameters, which you can create by pressing the plus button here. We want one called radius, which will be the radius of the diamond, and one called aspect ratio, which is a surprise tool that will help us later. We want to access these parameters as part of our post-processing material, PPM Persona Fade-In. So the easiest way I find is to physically just drag the collection from the content browser into the material screen and just drop it. That will give you a node that looks like this, and you can select which parameter it is you want to get a hold of. We want the radius, so select radius in the parameter name dropdown. Now that we have that radius, all we have to do is plug it into all the multiply nodes it wants to be in and bosh it, still won't do anything. That's because A, we haven't plugged it into this final node's emissive color point, which is where we send our completed data so the material knows what actually to do, because B, we still haven't done anything to check where the pixels are on the screen. To test that, we need a smartly named if node. An if node takes two values, A and B, and outputs a certain value based on whether A is less than, equal to, or greater than B. If we flash back to 30 seconds ago and we were talking about all of the coordinate geometry, we know that a point is inside the diamond if it's less than or equal to this multiplied radius value down here, right? So if we take this section and plug it into A and the multiplied radius value and plug it into B, we can plug different color profiles into less or equal to and greater than to tell the camera what to show. Hey everyone, Harry in the editing booth here. I'm just now realizing this part of the script doesn't really address the add node here or the whole thing here and oops. This add node is basically just doing the job of the addition sign in the equation because we need to add the coordinate positions and the connected radiuses to each other, which is why this works. We also need to compare it to the value of the x radius and y radius multiplied, and so I've taken the radius value from our parameter collection and multiplied it with itself. There are issues with doing that, which I get into later in the script, but this will at least give the two things you're meant to compare in the if node. I promise never to write video scripts at 3 a.m. again. It will happen again. We can put this bit from up here into less than and equal to, because if it's outside of that diamond, we want it to be the black and blue profile we set up. If it's greater than that, we want it to just render the content of the camera, which we can access using another scene texture node, this time pulling from post-process input 0, which we have to use because this is a post-processing material. Take all that, plug it into the emissive color thing, and look at that, a working diamond. There's still something not right with it though, the diamond is all skewed funny. That's because 0 to 1 along the top of the screen is not the same length as 0 to 1 up and down, which means that as a result, the radius of the diamond is different depending on which direction you're talking about. We can fix this using that aspect ratio value from earlier if we flash back to 30 seconds ago and we were talking about the aspect ratio value from earlier. Anyway, create a new multiply node and multiply the radius by your aspect ratio, then plug that into either the x or y calculation above. I use the y calculation because it's, closer. Then if you multiply the new aspect ratio adjusted version of your radius by the radius, you get a corrected version of that value for our if calculation over here. Fiddle with the aspect ratio value in your parameter collection until you hit on something you like. For production, you might need this value to be computed based on the resolution of the player's screen, but for our purposes here, we can just use this for now. And there we are. See it happening on the camera, create a new camera, find post-process material in the search bar, then add a new material to the array and select the material you've just created. You'll see the camera is now displaying the cube in blue and the world in black until you crank the radius up high enough and then you see it normally. I'll leave the more complicated camera movements and such as an exercise to the reader, although there's plenty of useful tutorials about sequences that I'll leave in the further reading for this video. What I'll just quickly add is that you can animate material parameters as part of a level sequence, which you do by creating a level sequence through the cinematic context menu, opening it, clicking track, material parameter collection track, and then select your collection. Then on the track, click this little plus button and select the parameter you want to animate, and then you can keyframe it just like anything else. In my sequence, I did something like the little camera move that the P3 transition does panning away from the character, then had the radius come up as it gets further away. If you're wondering why your screen doesn't look like mine, don't worry about it, I just color graded it really badly. Alright, that's about the size of it. This video is basically four other YouTube tutorials stacked up on each other in a trench coat, so I'll link to a bunch of further reading in the description, but I'll also create a project repo or some such that people can download it if they want and play with it themselves. Alright, make sure to